Thank you. Good morning. I'm Luc Bourlier, working for iBand. I usually mainly focus on making sure that other big tools are working fine with our products. But in this session, I will speak about dynamic resource allocation. So I will start with just a general view of dynamic resource allocation, and then speak more about what is specific in Spark, how it works in Spark. I need to speak about the external shuffle service to make sure that your thing is working fine, and then go through the different configuration and even try to go through advice on what values to use for the configuration. And a really short demo and speak a bit about dynamic resource allocation with Spark streaming. So dynamic resource allocation. The idea of dynamic resource allocation is just to try to provide to a job or an application the resources it needs when it needs it. And with the idea of that an application might not need always the same resources during its life cycle. So just to get a small example, we have a small job and it needs some resources to do its work. So the cluster assigns some resources and the job is happy and going forward and processing its data. But at some point, it kind of detects that, yeah, I could do with way, way more resources. So please give me more resources. And this cluster is not busy, so the cluster agree with the application and give it more resources. So that we are fine. And so now the process has a lot of resources and is going really, really fast and be able to do its computation as fast as it can. And really, really happy. But after a while, it starts to see that, well, it's nice. I mean, I have all those resources, but I don't really need that anymore. I needed the resources. It was really good to have all the resources before, but I don't need them anymore. So just ask, say, the cluster, say, OK, I don't need all those things anymore. And then the cluster adapt and respond to the requests from the application and free up resources so other people can use them. So why? Why using dynamic resource allocation? Because my example was nice, but I was showing only one element on the cluster, so it doesn't really make sense. So dynamic resource allocation really makes sense when you have a shared cluster. If you have your own, if you have a cluster which is dedicated to one specific task, you just assign all the resources to the job and it uses everything. But when you have a shared cluster, it usually makes sense to try to have something like dynamic resource allocation, especially if you have jobs which are variable load. So if, like in my example, the job at some point needs a lot of resources and then doesn't need so much anymore, it can just try to get more resources if they're available and free them up after the fact for other jobs to be able to use those resources. So yes, that's the basic idea of dynamic resource allocation, why you use it and how it works. So let's speak about dynamic resource allocation inside Spark. So this is the basic view of a Spark cluster, the architecture of a Spark cluster. You have the cluster manager, which is managing the nodes, and the driver program, which is speaking with the cluster manager, asking the cluster manager for some executors, and then the driver uses those executors to execute the tasks. So let's switch to a slightly different view. So I have a driver, which is my job, and one part which I kind of extracted from the driver is the scheduler. I mean, the schedulers, in fact. And when I speak about scheduler, I speak about three parts. So there's a task scheduler, where the driver gives the task he wants to run to the scheduler, and the scheduler sends the task to the executor to be run. There's a, in our specific case, there's an estimator. It's an estimator. I don't remember the name exactly right now. It's an estimator which tries to estimate the amount of work that needs to be done. And there is a cluster scheduler, which is doing the work of communicating with the cluster manager, saying that, OK, this is how much resources I would like. So I put everything in the scheduler box. That's what speaks with everything else. So the job starts. And the first thing that the job does is it says, OK, well, I need some resources to be able to run my, my application. And the job says, OK, I need two executors to start. This message is sent to the cluster manager, and the cluster manager communicates with the nodes and tells the nodes, please start executors. And after that, the executors are given to the driver, to the job, and the job starts to do the work on the executor. At some point, the schedulers, the estimator part of the schedulers, looked at the task scheduler and see that there's some tasks which are being waiting for a while in the task scheduler. And after a while, the estimator says, "Okay, those tasks have been waiting too long. We need more resources," and that's what it does. It communicates with the cluster scheduler and to ask the cluster manager, "Please give me more executors." And you get more executors, and those executors are added to the list of executors that the driver can use to run his tasks. So that goes well, and like in the first example. The workload shrank. And at some point, one executor doesn't even have any task to do anymore. There's so much work that there's nothing to do on the executor anymore. The tasks which are in the task scheduler cannot be run yet, and there's nothing to run on the executor. So the same way that the estimator was able to see that some tasks were waiting too long before being executed, the estimator also detects that the executor has been idle for a while. And it asks the cluster manager to please, I missed a step. So the first thing is it removes its connection to the executor because it doesn't need it anymore. And then it asks the cluster manager to please terminate the execution. And our application continued to work with this new configuration. So let's just get back to this stage. If you know a bit about the basic of Spark, the basic of Spark is that you do most of your computation in memory, and you try to keep all your information in memory as you can. So when we are in this state and there's an executor which is idle, not doing anything, it is not doing anything. It's not using any processing resources. We're still using some storage resources. There's some results. There's likely some results from previous operation which might be interesting for operation down the line. So when we go and we just tell the cluster manager to terminate the executor, we might lose data. There is some data that might be interesting for some other part of the job sometime later in the job. So to be able to manage that, we need to look at the external shuffle service. So did we lose any data? If we are just running without TSPs, external shuffle service, we will lose some data. There will be at some point that an executor is killed, and the data which was on the executor was something we needed later. So, I mean, we could always recreate the data. We have the full RDD graph of computation we need to get to this specific point. But if, because we try to reduce our cost, we need to do more computation, we don't reduce our cost, we just increase our cost. To be able to speak about the external shuffle service, we need to speak about shuffling itself. In Spark, mainly, and on other systems, but we are speaking about Spark here, the shuffle is split in two parts, shuffle write and shuffle fetch. So the way it works, so you get your data is going through some pipeline, through the map tasks, and you want to do an operation which requires shuffle, so something like a group by key, I mean any of those operations which are by key. So you need to do a shuffle. The first part of the shuffle is a shuffle write, when the resulting of the map operation are grouped by key in small bucket at the level of each executor, and the data is written on disk, in fact in Spark, to be able to be used later. And when all the map tests are done of all the aggregation on the shuffle write side has been done, then the reduce task can start, and the data on each executor for each reduced task, the shuffle fetch operation goes on all the executors to get the data it needs for the specific keys that the reducer is working on at the specific point. So you have the first part, which is the write sulfur white, which is a partial grouping by key or whatever you need, and the shuffle fetch, which is doing the final computation of all the data. So if we do just kill an executor, then we might be in the case that the data that has been written by the shuffle write is still useful, has not been used by the shuffle fetch yet. So we will lose data, and we will have to recompute it and all the things which are not nice. So the way the external shuffle works is that, in fact, you decouple the shuffle write from the main executor. It's part of the shuffle write is done by another application, a daemon running on the node, which is taking care of getting the data, writing the data on disk, and keeping the metadata. Because in fact, in this case, when you kill everything, well, what you lose really is not so much the data, because the data has been written on disk by the shuffle write. But what you really lose is the metadata. You don't know where the data is. You know the data is somewhere, but you don't know where the data is. And the way the shuffle write reads is it manages writing the data on the disk and keeps the metadata for being used during the shuffle fetch. So it's external shuffle service. It's a section which has been extracted from the executor and manages aggregated data for shuffle write. And it also maintains, so the external shuffle service is smart enough to be able to maintain this information not longer than is needed. So when you have a job running and you have an external shuffle service which is used, when your job is done, the data which is stored by the external shuffle service is also cleaned. So that's basically what we need. So we have the dynamic resource allocation, where you manage your resources themselves, and then you have external shuffle service to be able to manage the data. Let's speak about configuration. Start with the easy part. So there's a fair amount of options you can you need to use to get a dynamic allocation working fine. So the easy one are those ones. So just the one to enable it. Nothing much to say there. Initial executor, max executor, and min executors, which are just information to the estimator of how many executors to start to ask for when you start. What the maximum of number of executors you can ask to the cluster manager, and the low limit of how many executors you need to keep running, even if you don't have enough data, enough work for all the executors. And the more fun parameters, so scheduler backlog timeout. So scheduler backlog timeout is the value which is used by the estimator to know when to ask for a new executor. So the estimator has a view of the task scheduler, and it knows how long a task has been waiting on the scheduler. And if one of the tasks is the wait time of one of the tasks goes over this threshold, then the estimator will ask for an extra executor. And executor idle timeout is the opposite side, is how long the estimator will wait. The estimator check how long an executor has been without doing anything, and this is how long the executor will wait before telling the cluster to that it doesn't need the executor anymore and can release the resources. And the last one, sustained scheduler backlog timeout. It's useful because one thing to keep in mind when you set those values is it's not because you ask for an executor that you're going to get an executor right away. It will take some time for the executor to actually start. So this parameter allows you to configure how much delay between trying to ask again for my executors if adding just one is not enough. So it gives you, it allows you to wait for the executor to be up before starting to add four more. And so the last options which are required. So you need to enable the external shuffle service, and the port is the default, which is set, which is usable. But you do need to enable the external shuffle service It makes sense because it wouldn't work well with audit, and Spark doesn't even want to start a dynamic allocation if you don't have it enabled. Okay, let's just do a quick demo to show you how this thing is working. So I have a, it's too small, but it's fine. You don't have to read it. I have a small application which generates some workload on a Spark, and if we look at the timeline on the Spark, I need to make it bigger. If we look at the timeline on the Spark web UI, we are able to see what's happening. So, okay, so I started with a small task, just to be able to get the system up running, because I'm using fairly small values of my different set options. I need to kind of tweak a bit the thing, because I mean a good demo will take like 5 minutes to run to be able to show you real life things. So I have I have a small job, and then I have a big task. Which is running like 100 small, big job, which is running 100 small tasks. And so the estimator detects that, okay, there's a lot of tasks which are waiting, and we can ask for more executor. So, okay, oh yeah, I'm not speaking fast enough, if you believe. So the executor, there's one executor which is started, and then after a while, the estimator says, okay, we can use even more power. So it asks for another executor. And so a fourth executor is added. And then when this job is finished, my example switched to a job which does almost nothing and on a single partition. So it doesn't need any of those executors. And the executors get removed as it detects that it's not used anymore. And then we move to another piece of the application, which is again asking for fairly high amount of processing, and more executor added. And as we continue, I mean my workload is looping, so we see the same behavior all the time. So every time the estimator sees that there's more tasks to be run with the timeout, it adds more executor, and when it sees that the executors are not used, it kills the executor. So it's a really small example, and it's really to show you that it works well, and also that if you are playing with that, the timeline of your job is really useful to be able to see what's happening. You can see at what part, what time in your job, and what part of your job those executors are added or removed. So it allow you to get an idea of what's happening, to be able to tweak the configuration options. So let's speak about the configuration options. Values for the configuration options, and like a lot of things and things like that, it depends. It really, really depends on a lot of things. I will give you some basic ideas, but at some point you need to run and to it depends on a lot of points of your job. So the base configuration values, initial executor, max executor, mini executor, those ones are simple. This is basically what you want or what you are allowed to do. Initial executor is what you expect at the beginning of your job should be needing, and max executor is how much the people managing your cluster give you as resources at maximum. And minimum executor is just a safety net for you to not go too low. If part of the system, if a section of your job doesn't require too much resources. Scheduler backlog timeout. Okay, so you don't want it too short or too long. So you want it just right. So if you get it too short, the problem is you might start to ask for more resources just because you have a part of your job which has a lot of partitions, and it takes a bit of time, but not too long. But you have a lot of partitions to process, so you have a lot of tasks to process, and some of them may take a while before being scheduled. So you likely don't want to, and because it takes some time for an executor to start, you might get in the case that, okay, you're asking for a new executor, the estimator sees, okay, there's some work to do, it's asked for a new executor, and by the time the executor is started, well, in fact, you already finished this part of the job. So that's not very good. And being too long means that well, you could have used more resources for a while, but because your time limit was so long that you didn't detect the fact that you could use more resources fast enough, and for a while you were running your job at a slow pace when you could have been running at a high pace. So that's kind of why you want to get in between. And there's really no good values as a default. I think the default is a minute, if I remember well, if you don't specify anything, which is fine in most of the case as a starting point. But it really depends on the topology of your job, if you have a lot of small section of your job or longer or running sections. The system scheduler by clock timeout is to be able to not ask again and again for executor and wait for the new executor to be able to take some of the load before asking for new executor. And so, basic rule, at least the time it takes to start a new executor, so it depends on your system a bit. And the default is set to scheduler by clock timeout, and it's pretty good default. It basically means that when you ramp up, you can ramp up at a regular pace. In my example, I was on 10 seconds, so every 10 seconds, I will get a new executor if I needed it. Hello? Why? OK. Let's get back to it. That's not what I wanted to do. So, that's bad. Anyway, the next slide was about the idle scheduler timeout. So, on the way that without the aid, it's kind of harder to read. Yeah, I lost internet, apparently. Let me switch to hard copy. There you go. Hard copy for the save. OK, executor idle timeout. The problem if you get the scheduler backlog timeout too short is then you will start executor too often. On the other side, if you get the executor timeout too short, you will start to kill executor too often and too early. So if you get the scheduler backlog timeout small, you kind of, at the end, you're a bit optimistic of how much resources you may want to use. And if you get the executor idle timeout too short, then you are pessimistic of how many resources you want to use. And one thing you want to avoid is so when you get the map and reduce and the shuffle operation, most of the time before the reduce task can start, all the map tasks need to be finished. And you don't want to get in a case when, because your scheduler idle timeout is too small, then you kill executor while some partition are being processed in the map part. So you have a map part, the executor reduce part, and you don't want that while you're finishing to process the data of the map part, because there's only a few partitions to be left to be processed, that the estimator starts to kill executor. So it, as I said, it depends. It depends of the size of partition, how long it takes normally to run one partition and things like that. And having it too long is not your problem except cost. If you don't reduce the size of your cluster, it will cost more at some level for you to run your job. But that's basically it. Spark streaming. So I'm going to go fast on Spark streaming. Spark streaming, just to, as a reminder, data arrived during a batch interval is put in a RDD, which is processed as normal RDDs in Spark. So you have mini batch, which are trying to be run every batch interval. And on the point of view of the task scheduler, it's just there's a bunch of tasks which arrive every batch interval. So every whatever, let's say every 5 seconds, there's a Ubuntu task that arrives, and then nothing to do maybe for a while because the task has been processed, and then 5 seconds after, another set of batch tasks to process and forward. So if you want to use dynamic allocation for Spark streaming, you need to be even more cautious of what you do. You really definitively don't want the Sgitter idle timeout to be too short, because you don't want to start to kill executor because you finished executing all the tasks like 5 seconds before the next one restarts. Otherwise, the next set of tasks to be executed will be running on less executors, and which might be not enough to process the amount of data. But you can, with using dynamic allocation, you're able to be able to scale up your cluster in such a way that you don't, when you process streaming data, you will never be too late to process the data. It might take longer than your batch duration to be able to get the result of your processing, but it should never be getting too long. So what you want to do is the scheduler backlog timeout to be basically slightly longer than your batch interval to detect that, okay, it takes way, I'm delayed way too much. And the executor timeout to be some part of your batch interval to be able to say, okay, I have way too much time when I'm not doing anything, and I can kill some executors. One thing to keep in mind, it is not compatible with dynamic rate estimator. Dynamic rate estimator, which is my talk from last year, will make sure that you don't have too much data that you cannot process it during the batch interval, so you will never get, you will never have a delay too long. So you will never use that. If you configure it normally, you will never use dynamic allocation if you're also using dynamic rate estimator. Just a quick slide that if you think it's not enough, maybe go have a look at Cook, which is it is not a battery included system. You have to do a fair amount of things yourself to get it to work, but it allows you to also kill executor because you think that, I mean, this job is using too much resources. There was space for him to use all these resources, but now it's too much, so we can kill a few executors. But it's something that really, if it's not enough to do the normal dynamic, you can play with that. And that's my talk. So if you have any question.
Thank you. We've got questions for a couple of minutes. There's a mic in the back. Can you actually walk up there and just ask your question right there? There are two mics at the end of the aisle. We only have 2 minutes to answer this question before we actually can have some lunch.
All right. So my question is regarding the external shuffle service. So is there any plans to integrate that title with the cluster managers? Because now it's really external. It's something extra I have to operate separately.
Depend what system you're using, but I'm usually using Mesos as a scheduler manager. And if you just, even with Marathon, you can say to Mesos, please run an external scheduler on each of these nodes. And you can set a set of nodes which are set with external shuffle service. And with Marathon, you can just tell Mesos, please run it on all these nodes.
Yeah. All right. Thank you.
Okay, one more question, and then we're going to break for lunch.
Hello. So the external shuffle handles all the shuffle data. But what about the cache RDDs that are stored on the executors? What happened to them if the executor dies?
That's a good question. That's a good question. I don't know. Usually you care more about the shuffle data, but I don't know. I cannot tell you.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, go back ahead to Luke. Thanks a lot.
Thanks.
See you guys here.